Good morning, everybody. If you would stand and join us in worship.
You may be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to church.
It is good to see you all. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for joining us online. We're glad that you're with us, and we want to just welcome you. And a few things we want to do is we want to make sure that you are feel welcome to know who we are. So I'm Andrew, the associate pastor. This is David, our senior pastor. You'll hear from him in a little bit. And then Mark, our youth pastor, is up there. But we just want to thank you for being here. If you're here with us live in the room, your worship guides should be in your seats. If they're not, you can sneak over and grab one from a different row. Those of you online, they were posted on Facebook on Thursday, I believe, so make sure you grab those and see where we're headed with our service. And then for everybody, the worship or the response card is online. There's a link on the main page, so since we're not handing those out in a bulletin right now, you can fill that out at the top of the website. You can also give either on the plates on your way out the door or still use the online giving, mail-in, the app, text to give, all those opportunities. Thank you for those of you who are being faithful with that during this time. But those are your options. That's all for announcements. I'm going to get out of the way as far as announcements go. But I want to share some prayer needs with you and then take us to the Lord in prayer. Please continue to be in prayer for Debbie Loudermilk. Debbie was running a fever this week and was unable to get her chemo treatment, so she's home from the hospital, but she's still very weak and trying to gain strength, and we're praying that she's strong enough to be able to take her chemo this week, so please lift up Debbie in your prayers. Also be in prayer for Tiffany New and her family. We asked you to be in prayer for her grandfather, Bill Gamble. He fell and broke his back, and then he had pneumonia when he went into the hospital, and so Bill passed away this last week, so please pray for the Gamble family and then also for Tiffany and all those who are impacted by that. He was a good Christian man. We're thankful that he has received his reward, but we're praying now for the family. I want to be in prayer for Kenny Haddix. We keep updating you. Kenny had more spells this week with his heart rate and his blood pressure. And so pray for Kenny that he'll have physical relief and healing, but then also pray for him as he goes up to Cleveland this week that the doctors would be able to have wisdom. He's seeing a new doctor this time, and so pray that as he kind of gets him up to speed on the episodes that he's having, that God will provide the wisdom needed to give Kenny some help. How about your unspoken needs as well as unsaved friends and family members? We know the Lord goes before us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise you as the God of our salvation. Thank you for saving us. Thank you for bringing us together as your church. We pray today that as we worship, that we would bless you and that you would bless our worship. Prepare each of our hearts as we worship and help us to apply the word that you are going to give to us today through Pastor David. We ask for your forgiveness for those times when we've been so focused on ourselves that we have not loved you and loved others as you've called us to. Help us to fix our eyes on you today. We lift up those who've been named and the many more who have not. We pray for healing and for strength in Debbie's life and in Kenny's life. We ask for the peace and comfort for the Gamble family and for Tiffany. Lord, we pray for our nation and for our world. God, bring your peace. Bring your justice. And may we, as your church, model the love and the unity that we're praying for. We pray for the wisdom of our leaders. We pray for revival through your gospel and through your people. Lord, we're longing today to be all back together in person. Please give us a holy hunger to love one another and to seek ways to be personal and unified in the midst of our current situation. May this season remind us of the heavenly gift of community. We long for heaven, but we also long for the day that we can model that more fully in our community, in this church. We praise you, our Savior. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Yeah.
of the world. You step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to be. Fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus. The greatness of his mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry.
Lift your voices right now and sing this out as a congregation.
We fall.
And all the believers met together in one place and shared everything they had. They sold their property and possessions and shared the money with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in home for the Lord's Supper, and shared their meals with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all people. Each day, The Lord added to their fellowship those who were being saved. Acts 2, 44 through 47.
Good morning. How are you? I had to take a poll. I stop and think. How many of you have been with us at least 17 years? Anybody in here, Dale?
Yes.
Dale? Holy cow. We're old. My word. That's the worship set always reminds me. You may get tired of it. That worship set was our first worship set that we did together, Dale and I. It was up in a chapel 17 years ago in October this year. But that was the very first worship set. We've been together ever since. And every service, I might have to take my shoes off to count the times we've been apart and not been here together on Sunday. But it's been extremely rare, hasn't it? And we're neighbors, we're buddies, we're friends. But we just like being, we had some time last night. We got together and spent some time together as our families. We just like to be together. And I thought of that in light of the message we're talking about today, because that's really the point. We as believers should really want to be together, and that's what we're going to talk about today. Okay, we started off this series, and we're continuing now in 1 Thessalonians. I really am enjoying it. I hope you're enjoying it as well. It's an expositional study through this letter that Paul wrote to the church, and it's simply titled "In Progress." In progress. Everybody has seen these symbols, whether it's this blue electric circle, or the multiple colored circles, or the hourglass, or whatever you can recall. Every operational system has its symbol for in progress. You open an attachment to an email, and you're going to get some progress. You download a song, you're going to get in progress. You install a new program, you're going to get in progress. And that's the theory behind this series. As Christians, we should constantly be in progress, all the time. When we hear a sermon that God opens up His Word to us, we're in progress. When we hear a song by a Christian artist, and it just blesses our heart, and we receive something from it, we're in progress. When we start a new Bible study or a new Bible reading plan, we're in progress. When we get together and share our lives and share our troubles, we're in progress. Sadly, many church people don't get this. Dana and I had a neat conversation between services today, and I think it typically happens after you're saved. Wow, mom or dad prayed you in, or whoever it was prayed you in. You prayed that prayer. You accepted Jesus. You're good, right? You're good. You just need to continue to exist and go to church sometimes, and then when you die, you go to heaven. Yay, team. Yay, God. That's not Christianity. It's some kind of religion, but it's not Christianity. Christianity begins with our justification. That's when we're saved by grace through faith, nothing we've done. We hear the gospel as we've been talking recently. We accept it by the Holy Spirit as the words of God, and we receive Christ. We're saved. Yay. It's the beginning. It's not the end. The end is glorification. That's because we're saved. We put on glorified bodies just like Christ. We go to heaven, and we spend that existence there for eternity in a glorified body. So that's glorification. What happens in between? It's called sanctification. This is that process of growing to be more like Christ, being transformed by the renewing of our minds. That's what we're talking about here in this series. It's that process that we are growing in our faith. Okay? Now, we've talked about the fact that, and I just read this morning in my Bible reading, He gives us developers. He gives us pastors, teachers, mentors, spiritual leaders in our life that helps that progress, that helps take us along that path. And we've covered that. Unfortunately, the enemy knows how that works. And so he goes in to try to infiltrate that. He opposes that growth. And he uses people who've rejected Christ. And it may surprise us sometimes who he uses. So Satan's out to stop us. We talked about last week the fact he uses persecution. He tries to scare us out of our progress. Today we're going to take some further steps and see some other weapons that he uses to slow us down. Okay, here's the big idea. The big idea is the enemy wants to separate and isolate. He wants to separate and isolate us to block our progress. Okay, he wants to separate and isolate. Let me set the stage. Okay, there are some of you in this room that I call scrollers. Last time I talked about the clickers. This time I'm talking about the scrollers. And unfortunately, I have to confess I am guilty. Let me tell you what a scroller is. Okay? You open up Facebook, and you sit there, and you scroll, right? You just scroll. You open up Instagram, and you sit there, and you scroll, and you scroll. If you were my wife, you open up Poshmark, and you sit there, and you scroll, and you shop. All right? And me, I'll confess, it's eBay. You open up eBay, you call something up, you sit there. You know, me and Jacob's right there with me. We're looking for car parts and things, you know, anything that we just sit there and you scroll. Okay? And you scroll and you scroll, and before you know it, what happens? An hour, 2 hours, or even more is gone. I mean, nothing happened in your progress. Nothing happened productive. You just lost time in your life because you were sucked into this device, this thing. You know, you were going to do some laundry, but you scrolled and it didn't happen. You were going to cook dinner. You scrolled and it didn't happen. You were going to get to bed early tonight. Wow, I don't have anything to do this evening. I'm going to get 8 hours of sleep. No, I'm going to get six because I sat there and I scrolled. Right? It's anybody else besides me familiar with this? Has lost time to this? Amen? Right? This is what I want to talk about. These things are really handy. That phone right there that's recording the service is really handy. The fact that we can have Facebook church is really handy. All these things are nice. But man, at some point we got to put them down and be together. Sometime we got to make sure that we're doing things face to face and in person and not just scrolling our life away. So I'm going to encourage you to turn over to 1 Thessalonians. And you can scroll this time. It's perfectly legal. And get to 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Verses 17 through 20, and let's see what Paul says about the desire to be together. Let's see if we can grasp some of his passion. Won't you stand with me, please, as we read and honor the reading of God's Word. Just a couple of short verses here. If you're at home, you can stand with us and participate as well. You'll have the words on the screen. This is the Word of God to us. It says, "Dear brothers and sisters," so he's talking to Christians, "after we, the ministry team, were separated from you for a little while, though our hearts never left you, we tried very hard to come back because of our intense longing to see you. We wanted very much to come to you, and I, Paul, tried again and again, but Satan prevented us. After all, what gives us hope and joy, and what will be our proud reward and crown as we stand before our Lord Jesus Christ when he returns? It's you. Yes, you are our pride and joy." Let's pray. Father God, thank you for the gathering of believers, and thank you for those who are taking that opportunity to get out now because they know they need to be together. And so I know you're going to bless us today. We're going to continue in our progress of sanctification, growing in our faith because of these efforts that have been made, but more importantly, because you're going to pour yourself into us this morning. Thank you for your word, which is truth. Now guide us in it. I pray for every believer who came that the desire will be to make sure we're not hindering progress, that we're not allowing the enemy to separate us and isolate us, that we know that we need to be together. And I pray for those who aren't Christians, maybe who are watching. Somebody told them to check us out, and they did. So I just pray that you'll bless their hearts this morning, that they'll get a real picture of what Christianity is. It's not just some religion, some list of rules that we follow. It's all about relationships. Relationships we have with each other because the relationship we have with you. Bless our hearts, all of us today. Remove me from your word and speak through it. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Please be seated. All right, if you've already heard and already figured out, the subtitle is "Too Much Screen Time." I got the idea from something that comes up on my phone on a regular basis that probably comes up on yours. It'll say, your screen time is up 8% this week, or up. Anybody get those warnings from their phone? And you know, it is convicting. It really is convicting to me. I'll say, man, I am wasting so much time, and I'll stop and shut down what I'm doing, and I'll lay the phone down for a little while, but then I'll pick it back up again. And it just happens. So I thought about that, and I thought, you know what? That's what I want today to be. I want today to be that warning that, hey, we got our nose in our computers too much. We got our nose in our laptops, our nose in our cell phones, and we don't have our nose in each other's faces, and we're not together as much as we need to be. And I hope we'll get that picture today. We should desire to be together, All right? We should desire to be together. So let's start with that. Believers should long to be together. Believers should long to be together. According to the commentators that I use for this message, the English translations in most of these Bibles are pretty weak. They don't really communicate Paul's passion as well as they could. And so I'm going to bring together some of that to help you understand what his passion was for the church. First thing we need to look at is it hurt to leave. It hurt to leave. We'll talk about this more in a few minutes, but I'll introduce it here. Paul didn't leave Thessalonica because he wanted to. And he didn't leave when he wanted to. Paul's typical method of ministry would be go into the town. We'll talk about it here in a minute, how he ministered. But he would stay for months and maybe even years. He stayed for at least 18 months in Corinth because he wanted to see the progress. He'd see people saved. He'd start pouring himself into their lives, start discipling them. And then he wanted to see them progressing before he left. And so usually he would stay for a while, but not this time. This time he had to leave in a hurry. And when he did, it hurt. It literally hurt him to leave. Let me explain what I meant about the English weakness. In verse 17, it begins with, "But brethren," or brothers and sisters, "having been taken away from you." That's bad, but it's not as bad as he's really communicating in the early language. The participle actually translates better to having been torn apart, a wrenching apart. And it would have been used in first century writings, secular writings, in a couple of situations. One is maybe a child dying, a child wrenched from the parent's arms in death. Or on the other side of it, a child orphaned by the death of both parents. That is the strength of his passion that he's communicating here. That's how much it hurt him to leave. I don't understand either one of those scenarios. I haven't had to go through, you know, the death of a child or being orphaned. But I thought of a very relative illustration. How many of you have had a service member that has been deployed and you've had to say goodbye? Or been the one saying goodbye? All right, I've had to do it 3 times so far, and I've got to do it again next year. That is one of the most gut-wrenching things that you'll ever experience in life, is to say goodbye to your family when you know it's going to be maybe a year before you see them again. That's hard. That's how I visualize. That's how I can feel in my own heart the longing that Paul had and the hurt that he felt when he left. Isn't that something? You stop and think, that's how badly he wanted to be together with other Christians. It literally hurt him to leave, just like it would be to lose a child or a child being orphaned or being separated for a long period of time. That's pain. That's how much it hurt. I get that passion now when I dig a little deeper. I hope you get the passion as well. He wasn't just notching his gun belt for evangelism. Yay, I led 27 people to the Lord in that town. I led 33 in this town. He wasn't notching his gun belt. He wasn't padding his resume. Hey, I planted 6 churches in Thessalonica. All right, no, he wasn't padding his resume. He was literally building real, genuine relationships with people because they shared a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's the way church should be. That's the way church should be, okay? It should be that powerful. It hurt him to leave, and then it hurt him to be kept apart. It hurt him to leave them, and it hurt him to be kept apart. Paul left Thessalonica in a hurry. Then he went to the next town of Berea. Most of us know about the Bereans. They were open-minded people, but he had to leave there in a hurry too. The same thing happened. Again, I'm going to cover that in a minute. To keep him alive, though, his friends shipped him away to Athens alone. Right, alone. So he wasn't just separated from the church. He was isolated from the church and from his own team. He was left alone. That's so powerful, and that's how much it hurt. Again, verse 17, the English falls short. Some translations say he was eager with great desire. The NLT is pretty close. It says out of an intense longing. And the original phrase, the original expression, is a dominating passion. It's compelling or even controlling. And in secular Greek writings, the phrase is used to denote a sexual passion. That's how much it hurt him to be kept apart from the church. Can you hear it now? Can you hear how much pain he's in? It was genuine love that he had for other believers and a genuine desire to be together. All right, what's happening to Paul is he's showing a difference between religion and Christianity. Right, he's showing a clear difference. Religion are these guys that's coming behind him. They're teaching the legalism, follow the law, follow this order. If you're going to be right with God, you got to do A, B, C, and D. And you know what? They didn't love these people. When they left the area, they didn't shed a tear. But Paul is saying, no, this is about a relationship. Christianity's real. I love you. We love God. We love being together. He's showing the difference between a religion and a real Christianity. And that's what Paul is trying to do here, illustrate in this passage. It should hurt not to be together because we have this relationship. That's one thing I want to give praise to this church for. Over the last few months, I've heard it many times from different members on different occasions. I need to be in church. I need to be back with people. I have even had one person tell me, you know, I used to think I wasn't a people person. I used to think I liked being alone, but I realize I need people, and these are the people I need. So that's this church, and I'm very proud of it. We understand the truth, and this is the truth. It's five words, and if you get nothing else in the sermon, get this. We need to be together. We need to be together. All right, our progress is greatly increased when we are together. If church, and this is something, if church is just a matter of hearing a sermon, why do we need to be here? If church is just a matter of finding good preaching, you're looking in the wrong place. There are some awesome preachers out there. If you gave me a choice, I wouldn't listen to me. All right? I'd be listening to Charles Stanley. Charles Stanley's my favorite. Listen, he says, listen, listen, listen. I love to listen to Charles Stanley. Chuck Swindoll, man, the ex-Marine, the Harley-Davidson riding pastor. Man, he's an awesome speaker. Or I listen to David Jeremiah. Right? He has such a sense of humor that he brings to the message. Or I'd get online and listen to Al Mohler. And there are so many other good speakers out there that if it's just a matter of hearing a message, man, we can hear it. We got cable. We got internet. We can listen to sermons anytime we want. We can watch them online anytime we want, anytime we feel like it. So if it's just a matter of listening to sermons, that's not church. If it's just a matter of studying a Bible, man, I've got on this any translation of the Bible I want. I can read the NIV, NIV, NASB, ESV, NLT, King James. I can read whatever I want in large print so I can actually read it. I mean, I could scroll through the text all by myself. I don't need church for that. I could do that, right? I can, you know, when you stop and think about it, I can have my relationship with Jesus Christ without church, right? Wrong. We need each other. We need to be together. Again, anybody can listen to a sermon. Anybody can read a Bible. But not just anybody can have this relationship. This relationship is powerful. We need to be together. All right? Now, you've heard me share it before, and I hope you believe me. We do not allow politics to influence our message. We don't do politics in our church. I believe if Jesus was alive today, he wouldn't be a Democrat or a Republican. He'd be independent. And we as a body have to be independent as well. So I need to say that because I don't want you to get the wrong idea of what I'm about to say. I believe it's highly possible that this effort to keep us apart indefinitely is an effort of our enemy. This effort to keep us at least 6 feet apart or to keep us home is an effort of the enemy to stop the progress of the church. I have no doubt in my mind that this is an effort of our enemy. We can't continue to do this indefinitely. We have to get back together. All right? We have to get back together. We should have the same passion for each other that Paul had for the passion or for the people of Thessalonians. That doesn't mean we throw wisdom out the window. That doesn't mean we take unnecessary risks, right? We still have responsibilities. But remember, what's the enemy's main virus? Do you remember that from last week, anybody? Fear. The enemy's main virus is fear. And so we got to stop and think about the decisions we're making today. Are we making decisions based upon facts and being responsible, or are we making decisions based upon fear? Is fear keeping us apart? If it's fear, it's not okay. If it's wisdom, that's one thing, but if it's fear, it's not okay. So let's not make our decision to be apart based upon fear. We need to be together. So Paul expresses his genuine love and desire, passion for the church. And in doing so, he describes the efforts of the enemy. So let's talk about the other side. Let's talk about Satan. Satan longs to keep us apart. Satan longs to keep us apart. As we discussed last week, we have flesh and blood, people who Satan uses to oppose us very clearly. Those who do not accept Christ wind up being our opposition. And so let's consider what the opposition is trying to do. The enemy separates, okay? The enemy separates. As I said a minute ago, I would come to this. Paul goes to Thessalonica, and he does what he does in every other city. He goes to the synagogue. The synagogue is the spiritual head of whatever community you're in. And it's where everything happens. It's a community center. Stuff happens in the synagogue every day. But the Sabbath day is the Lord, is the day that they share the word. And so you've got Jews that go to the synagogue on the Sabbath just like they're supposed to. And you've got God-fearing Gentiles that sit in the back row, that literally, they're not allowed to participate in the ceremonies, but they can be there, right? They're searching for God. And so they're there, and they're listening to the text. Paul, being a Jew, can go into the synagogue, into the Jewish service, and he can open up the Torah, he can open up the text. And what could Paul do, being a Christian now? He can take the messianic prophecies of the Old Testament, and he can say, this is Jesus. This is the guy we saw walk on water. This is the guy we saw heal the sick and raise the dead. This is Jesus. He fulfills these. So that's what Paul is doing in every city. So he does it in Thessalonica. He shares the messianic passages. He evangelizes, and both Jews and Gentiles get saved. Yay, God, right? Yay, God. But if you read that passage in Acts 17, it says those who rejected him get jealous. You ever wonder why that happens? You go and you tell two people about Jesus. You got two people, person A, person B. You tell them both the same thing about Jesus. You explain who he is, why we need him. Person A rejects him. Person B accepts him. Holy Spirit moves. He understands it's true. Person B, right, has got Jesus. Person A says, I don't need it. I don't want it. Why can't he just walk away and leave person B alone? You ever think about that? Why can't he just go on about his business if he chooses not to believe? Because our enemy wants to oppose us and will use those who reject Jesus Christ to do so. And that's exactly what happened. In Thessalonica, these people that rejected the message hated them so much that they went down to the market and they got some bad characters, is how the NLT puts it, and they start a riot. You realize rioting's not something new. Rioting's been used by the enemy since the beginning of time. Riot's a powerful weapon because you get into groupthink and you get into moving people and you get people upset and angry until they don't even know what they're doing because someone has stirred them up. That's exactly what they did in Thessalonica. They went and they stirred up a riot down at the market, and they come to get Paul and they come to get Silas and Timothy, and they're going to have street justice. Right? That's what a riot does. That's what a mob does. I want street justice. I don't want justice. I really want vengeance. And so they're out to get vengeance now, and they can't find Paul and Silas and Timothy, but they hear, hey, this guy, one of our people, Jason, I think they're staying at Jason's house. Let's go get Jason. Let's go see if they're there. Well, they don't find Paul and Timothy and Silas at Jason's, but they drag Jason out to the street. And they even take Jason down to the local magistrate, and he gets arrested. For what? For being one of these people that helped Paul and Timothy and Silas. He has to post bond. He has to put up property to get out of jail, to go back home. And so Paul and Timothy, they leave that town that night, and they get separated from the church. Right? That's what happens. They get separated from the church. Then the enemy isolates. You can take the story a little further before we do application. They loved him so much that they protected him. They were shields for Paul and Timothy and Silas. And they send him to Berea. The same thing happens in Berea. He goes to the synagogue. The God-fearing Gentiles and the Jews hear the message. Some get saved. Some turn against him again. They start rioting again. So they kick Paul out and they send him down to Athens where he's isolated all by himself. And some think, as Paul is saying, Satan kept me from going back. Most scholars believe he wouldn't go back because Jason would lose the bond money that he put up. Jason will lose his property that he put up for bond if Paul came back to town. So many believe when he says Satan wouldn't allow him to come back, they think that's why. He couldn't go back because Jason would suffer for it. And so that's an important thing to see. Satan uses these weapons to isolate people, to get them alone. Thankfully, it didn't defeat Paul, but it defeats Christians today. Separation and isolation defeats many Christians today. Now, put it neutral for a second and make some application. I've already mentioned the pandemic. I've alluded to the pandemic and what it's done to us by isolating us and keeping us apart. It's a rare event. It's unprecedented. That's true, and we'll figure this out. But stop and think about the other things that the enemy uses to separate us and isolate us. What else does the enemy use? Well, he uses bitterness, doesn't he? Can the enemy use bitterness to separate and isolate us? Absolutely. Somebody says something or does something in our church and it offends us, and we smile and we say we're okay and we're not really okay. We have an issue and we don't resolve it, and that turns into bitterness, and every time we see that person, we get mad, we get upset. So we stop coming to church, we separate ourselves. And eventually we will isolate ourselves because we'll just move on until we don't come to church anymore, all out of bitterness. How about pride? Can pride cause separation and isolation? Absolutely. Maybe someone doesn't get enough attention that they think they should have, or someone doesn't get enough praise for the things that they do. Pride can separate and isolate. How about politics? Politics is one of the biggest separation and isolation issues there is. It's huge. Maybe someone is so radical in one political position that they can't possibly believe someone who opposes them loves Jesus. I've heard stuff like that. Political issues can isolate and separate people from the church. Can Satan use these things? Absolutely. Absolutely. Does all the time. That's what Paul says in verse 18. This is where the visual comes in. In verse 18, he says that Satan blocked our way. Some translations you'll have will say Satan hindered us. That word in the Greek is a military term. It's a military term that means to disrupt the advance of the opposing army. Right? Satan hindered. He disrupted the advance of the opposing army. And I thought several things through. World War I, trench warfare, if you studied history at all, the trenches across the Western Front were to keep the enemy from going across and pursuing. Right? Trenches were that. You got that picture in your mind. Some of these things are a trench. World War II, if you've studied anything about World War II, that was tank warfare. And how did they stop tanks from going in? They blew up bridges. They would poke holes in the ways that they got into cities and towns. They would blow up their own bridges, as a matter of fact, just to stop the movement of the enemy. What do we do now in modern warfare? Well, modern warfare now is air power. You got to have air power to support land power. How do we do that? We got to take airplanes off the ground. So what do? We blow up airline strips. We drop bombs on airstrips, poking holes in airstrips so that airplanes can't take off. See, that's the picture that Paul is saying. Satan is trying to hinder the work through these things. So we got to stop here and think, am I poking holes in the runway? That's the self-evaluation. Am I personally guilty of bitterness, of pride, of politics, of whatever? Am I guilty? Am I putting hindrances in the way of progress, or am I filling those holes? And we'll talk about filling them here in a minute. What am I doing? What part am I playing? Am I pushing towards us being together or being apart? All right? Am I hindering or am I helping? So, back to the teaching passage. Paul spent some time in Athens alone. When the team catches up, they move down to Corinth, and that's where he writes this letter back. He couldn't get the Thessalonians off his mind. He wanted to encourage them. He wanted to be encouraged by them. He couldn't go back. So he writes this letter that we're reading from Corinth and sends a ministry team member back. And we'll talk about him next week. For now, let's consider how in that time they were apart, Paul comforted himself and those that he wrote the letter to. All right, so Satan ultimately fails. This is our last part. Satan ultimately fails. He cannot separate us. He cannot isolate us forever. He can temporarily do it, but he can't do it forever. Paul uses some interesting terms in verses 19 and 20 that we're going to spend a lot of time on in a couple weeks. One of my favorite sermons comes out of chapter 4 and 5. We'll get there, so pay attention. Be close. But let's warm up with a taste of this. This is an important truth that Paul uses here, and he uses several of these words twice. He says, you believers, you guys in Thessalonica, you're our hope. You're our hope. How do we get through this separation? How do we get through this isolation? You're our hope. In three of these points, He uses a specific context. He uses when Jesus comes back, the parousia, when Jesus comes back. He's talking about the rapture of the church. He says, all right, how am I comforted in my sufferings? I'm thinking about when Jesus comes back. I'm thinking about the promise Jesus made that he would return. And you're our hope, right? We see you. We see the way you're living. You really got the gospel. You're making a difference. You're genuinely saved. We have the same hope. We will spend eternity together. When Jesus returns, we'll be reunited. You are our hope. And then he says, you are our joy. You're our joy. How do we take persecution? Because we know, we can look at you and see you and know that we're going to be together for eternity. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. I picked that song on purpose, right? I picked it on purpose because there's a day of rejoicing coming ahead. That's how Paul could endure these things. That's how the Thessalonians could endure it, knowing that, hey, there's great joy ahead when Jesus returns. And finally, he says, you're our victory. You're our victory. You're worth fighting for. This comes out when he says you're our glory, you're our crown. He's not talking about a golden diadem. He's talking about Stephanos or Stephanus. That would have been a garland that would have been given out at Greek games for an athlete who won. They would have got this Greek wreath, this thing made out of plants, and that would have been their sign of victory. And Paul says, look, you guys, you're our victory. You're the evidence of the success of the gospel. You're the evidence of the evangelism. You are our victory, and that's how we celebrate. We know when Christ returns, because of this, we'll all be together again forever. Forever. And that's how he endures his troubles. So, conclusion. Paul was hurt. I mean, you can hear his hurt. He was hurt because he was separated from them. He was hurt because he was kept from them. He really wanted to be with them because he knew we are better together than we are apart. And yet he also could rely on the fact, you know what? If that doesn't happen, I'm still looking forward to eternity with you. Wow. So get back to the challenge I made earlier. The first challenge for the invitations for us Christians. We've got to picture that runway. Are we making holes or are we filling them? Are we causing problems so that there's separation and isolation in the church? Or are we filling those holes so that we can make sure we're better together? That's where we stop back and look in the mirror of God's word. I don't know what issue it might be. Maybe it was some of the issues I mentioned because I just picked a few. Maybe it's something else. Are we filling holes or are we making holes? Are we hindering progress or are we helping progress? Are we making sure we are together? All right, we need to be together. We need to be together. If you're not a Christian, it may be difficult to grasp a concept like this. I assure you, and I've been to churches like this, if an unsaved person walks into some church, they're going to be turned off immediately because there's people there that don't like each other, and it's obvious. There's people there that are only there out of obligation. I just come because I have to come to church. Mom makes me. Dad makes me. There are people there for all the wrong reasons. They don't have a relationship. They've got a religion, or at least a form of it. And that's not attractive to anybody. That's not attractive to anybody, especially an unsaved person. Like, man, what do I want to be a part of that for? Well, hopefully you'll find something better here at Winfield Baptist Church. But more importantly, hopefully you'll find something what I said at the end. You and I are eternal beings. That's why we come to church. We're trying to figure that out. All right, we will live somewhere after we die. It's heaven or hell. And what we do about Jesus Christ is the difference. So let me share something. Paul and his team would go to those synagogues and they would share some truth. We don't know exactly what. But let me share something that Paul would have known. This is something from a friend of Jesus. John recorded it. He said this. He said, "Don't let your hearts be troubled," Jesus speaking. "You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I'm going." Well, there's probably people that are listening here, or maybe even here, that are like Thomas. We give Thomas a bad rap because we call him Doubting Thomas, when honestly, he should get a better name than that because he was the only one bold enough to speak up. Right? He was bold enough to say, "Lord, We, not just me, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way? To that, Jesus gives this familiar response. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh unto the Father except by me. By me. One way or another, you'll face Jesus Christ. You either face him as a good and faithful servant who has trusted in him, believed in him, been justified by faith, or you'll face him as his enemy who he says, depart from me, I didn't know you. The difference is what you do with the truth about him today. If you'd like to talk, we'd love to talk, whether it's here or whether it's online, whatever it takes. We'd love to help you find that victory that Paul spoke about so you can have the hope and the joy of that future reunion. Father, thank you for your words, their truth. Now guide us in them as we respond. We have to respond because your word is living and it works in our life every time we hear it. And so, Father, thank you for those who took the extra effort to be here today. Thank you for those who couldn't. They're responsible. They understand that maybe there's some vulnerabilities that they need to be careful of, and we expect that. But God, we need to be together. I pray for our nation. I pray for us all to come together in multiple things that are going on in our world today. May we be the shining examples as believers of the harmony and unity that can be found through Jesus Christ. Father, for those who may have found themselves poking holes in the runway, I pray that they'll repent today. Pray that they'll get right with you and get right with others so that they can continue to be close to the body of Christ and continue in their progress. For those who aren't Christians, Father, I pray that they understand the truth, and they only do that because you let them, because you move their hearts and you allow them to understand that this is the word of God, not the word of man. Maybe today will be the day of their salvation. Give them the courage to speak up and say, I don't, just like Thomas, Lord, we don't know the way, and allow us the opportunity to tell them. So God, we love you and we thank you. Bless your invitation in Jesus' precious name. Amen. This is your time to respond.
Love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished.
Would you stand and sing this last one with us, please?
But I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart. His wounds have paid my ransom. And why should I gain from his reward? I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
There we go, that's better. Thanks for coming. It's good to see you all. Good to be together. Hope you can say the same. Keep your eyes and ears open. Watch our Facebook page. Watch the web page. We are now putting together the plan to return to green phase for us, which is normal. Wednesday night Bible study, Wednesday night Juana's, Sunday night life groups, and Sunday mornings regular services. So we will progressively get there. And so there'll be changes coming up in the next few weeks to start to work that way. But again, thank you for coming. Keep your eyes and ears open. We'll announce everything multiple times. Do it on the Call 'Em All, do it on the website, do it on Facebook. But we are making plans. We're listening to wisdom, and we're also making sure we're not acting out of fear, because we need to be together. We really need to be together as a church. And so thank you for that desire. Thank you for being here. If we don't need chairs, right? That's right. We do need them? Okay, the ones you're sitting in, just your section you're sitting in, if you can stack them, we'll swap them out for tonight's service. Still another 6 o'clock service to have this evening. If you got questions or comments or concerns, let us know. I'm going to stick around. I'm not in a hurry. I'd love to talk to you. But again, Lord bless you and keep you. And thank you for being here. Dale, would you close us in a word of prayer?
Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord God, for allowing us to be in your house once again. Thank you for all the folks that made it out this morning to the first service and again here to our second. Lord God, we pray that you continue to keep your arms of protection around each and every one of us, Father God. Keep us safe. Most of all, Lord God, help us to shine the light into this dark, cold world that we live in. Thank you so much for Jesus, for the cross at Calvary, and for the blood that covers my sins. Thank you for our salvation. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
God bless.